let me see that map. Here's Al-Ghul.
As I remember, it should be on the left, but I don't believe it.
It is. And here's Braemar.
It should be on the right.
It is. Now, where are we?
What's in the middle?
Nothing.
That's where we are.
In nothing?
Yes, and for a fellow with my potentialities, this is an ideal location. We'll find our way out when the sun comes up.
Fine couple of game hunters we are. We come all the way out here from New York, and on the first night out, we get lost.
Maybe we took the high road instead of the low road. Do you like a drink?
No, thanks.
Good, that leaves more for me.
Wait a minute, didn't you tell me you're gonna cut down on that stuff?
Yes, I did, but I'm a terrible liar. Besides, it doesn't pay. I remember one time I was going with this wonderful girl, and she would just plead with me and plead with me to give it up. So one day I did. Then we discovered we had nothing more to talk about, so we broke up.
There's something about this forest that gives you the feeling of being in a cathedral.
Well, if we were, I'd know where the exit was.
You don't believe in anything, do you?
Of course I do.
Really? What?
Practically anything I can understand. You know, anything that's real to me. Like things I can touch, taste, see, hear, smell, and swallow.
What about the things you don't understand?
I dismiss them.
It makes everything very easy, doesn't it?
Comfortable is the word.
I envy you, Jeff.
Why?
You seem to be very satisfied.
I am, aren't you?
No. I'm not.
That's the silliest thing I've ever heard. You've got a fine job, you're engaged to a fine girl, and you're lost in a fine forest. What more do you want?
I don't know, but something seems wrong. Especially about Jane and me, which makes everything seem wrong. Look at how I postponed getting married. I just can't get myself to that altar.
I don't know what could be wrong about it. She's young, attractive, fits smack into your niche in life, and on top of that, she loves you. And just the proper amount, too.
What's the proper amount?
Enough to make you happy, and not enough to embarrass your friends.
It looks ideal, doesn't it? Why don't I see it? I must be lacking somewhere.
Now, don't start talking yourself into an inferiority. You don't deserve it.
What do you mean?
Well, most of my friends who have inferiority complexes are absolutely right. They're not as good as everyone else. But someone like you who is...
Wait a minute. Do you hear that?
Yeah.
Shh.
Look over there. It looks like a...
There at the square, laddie.
Come
here.
I'm selling the sweetest candy here that ever shall boost a tooth. I need it myself, and there's no doubt it's creamy and good and thick. So lassies, I hope you buy me out. Tis making me kind of sick.
Two bonny daughters.
Good morning, Mr. Beaton.
What would you be looking for, Miss Fiona?
A biscuit for my father, for the wedding.
Why, of course. You and young Charlie Dalrymple are getting married this evening, aren't you, Miss Jean?
Aye, Mr. Beaton.
Well, if you had to choose someone other than my son, Harry, I'm glad there's a lad as fine as Charlie.
Aye, Mr. Beaton.
You must be happy as a lark in the glen.
Aye, Mr. Beaton. As you say, Mr. Beaton, Jean is a wee bit short of words today.
Father says I shouldn't talk too much. He says when I speak, I sound so happy he finds it annoying.
Is that what you said, Mr. McLaren?
Aye, indeed, Archie. Besides, when a lass gets married, she must get used to listening and not talking.
Oh, I didn't think Charlie will have too much trouble with Miss Jean here. She's a good maiden.
Look, Archie, all maidens are good. So tell me where all the bad wives come from. Friends, gather round. Mr. Lundy has written upon this parchment a few reminders, and he has asked me to read it in the public square where you can all hear it and be reminded.
Aye.
This is the second day of our blessing, and this is to remind you of the obligations which we have all so gratefully accepted.
Your father likes to take charge of things, doesn't he, Miss Fiona?
Aye, especially after everything's been done. Would you have a waistcoat of this that would fit him?
Oh, I think so, Miss Fiona.
Hello, Harry.
Oh, hello, Jean.
How are you today?
How do you expect me to be? It is your wedding day, isn't it?
I'm truly sorry, Harry.
Oh, well, don't be. If anybody's going to pity me, let it be me. Trapped forever without you in this peasant village.
What did Angus say, Harry?
I forgot.
Hello, Harry.
Hello, Fiona. It just isn't fair for Charlie Dolan to be winning you. He's got everything. School, Edinburgh, and now you. And I got nothing.
Harry, take this material to the house and see if there's a whisker of it there.
Nothing but to be doing this all my life.
Why didn't you pay attention to Maggie Anderson? You know she has a yearning for you.
Aye, Father.
Oh, Fiona, I feel so sorry for you.
I know, darling.
Mr. Beaton, you didn't hate me for not loving Harry, do you?
No, Miss Jean. Sometimes I think the only woman that could have loved and helped him was his mother, rest her soul.
Come, Jean. You'll be staying with your father today. And Fiona, you'll be sent to buy everything that's needed for the wedding supper.
I will, Father.
Remember, just what's needed. My aim on this occasion is to be hospitable, not philanthropic. Come, Jean.
You'll send the waistcoat to the house, Mr. Beaton.
Aye, Miss Fiona.
Good morning, Fiona.
Hello, Meg. A jug of cream, please.
Mr. McGuffey will be pleased as a last buy-in for a change.
Oh, why?
When the lads come shopping, they look so handsome I didn't like to ask them for money.
Oh, but you'll never make a profit doing that.
No, but I make a great many friends.
Is this for the wedding tonight?
Aye.
Fiona, when are you going to think about marriage for yourself?
When I find someone who makes me think of it. And you've never found anyone up till now who made you think of it?
No. You see, I didn't want to just get married. I think you should only do it when you and your lad want to stay together fiercely. And getting married is the only way to do it. It's proper.
That's an unusual idea, Fiona.
Many a lassie, as everyone knows her, tried to be married before 25. So she'll agree to most any proposal. All he must be is a man and a lie. I have a dream. You see.
you tell us where we are?
Aye, you're in Brigadoon.
Brigadoon?
Aye.
That's funny. There's no town called Brigadoon on the map.
I shouldn't be surprised.
You mean you know it isn't on the map?
Aye.
It's a little snobbish of you, don't you think?
Why isn't it on the map?
For good and sound reasons.
Could you tell me what y'all are all dressed up for? Is this the day you take pictures for postcards or something?
We're not dressed up.
You mean you always go around with all those clothes on?
No.
Now come on. Somebody, what's going on here? What is this?
We're having a fair.
Oh. Is that milk you're selling there?
Aye.
Can I buy some? I'm thirsty. We've been walking all night.
I'll have to see your money first.
What? Let me take a look at it.
What did you give him? A hunk of uranium?
Just a shilling. What a loony layout this is.
Very interesting, sir. But it does me no good.
What do you mean it does you no good? Sell me something and it will.
I'm very sorry, sir, but I cannot sell you anything. However, if you're thirsty, I'll give you some milk.
Never mind. I don't want any favors.
I see from the coin you're from England.
No, we're from America.
You're American?
I am. He's from Georgia. Come on, boy.
No, wait, please. We didn't mean to act so strangely. We're just a wee bit taken aback. People didn't come here very often.
I can understand why. You people stare at us as if we just dropped in from another world. Does that amuse you?
Aye, very much.
Quiet, Meg.
Obviously the daughter of two first cousins.
If you've been walking all night, you must be tired and hungry. Wouldn't you like some food to eat and perhaps a place to lie down before you start back?
That's very nice of you. Thank you.
Good. And I'm Fiona McLaren.
I'm Tommy Albright. And this is Jeff Douglas.
How do you do, sir? I'm Meg Brocky.
I'm glad you're happy about it.
There's a little tavern on the next street where we can get some food. I'll take you to it.
You go ahead, Jeff. I'll call the inn first.
Excuse me, sir, but is Miss Meg going to take care of you?
I think so. Why?
Well, I have a pair of plaid trousers here, and after you leave the tavern, it makes you take you someplace to rest, and you should happen to rip your own on a thistle. I'd be more than happy to replace them for you.
Thanks, old man, but I don't expect to get stuck.
Oh, you didn't know it, laddie, but you're stuck now.
Oh, you tend to your selling, Mr. Beaton.
What a place. Is there a phone around here?
A phone?
Yes.
I didn't think we have one.
No phone?
No, sir.
Tell me, what's so strange about this place?
Nothing, sir. You're the one who's strange.
Charlie! Here's a bottle of claret. Have a dram of good luck with me.
Aye.
Charlie, the merry bridegroom himself.
Bridegroom?
Aye.
Good morning, darling.
He's marrying my sister this evening.
Oh.
Good morning, sir.
Good
Charlie,
morning.
Charlie, this is Tommy Albright. He just happened in a little while ago.
What? Oh. Why, of course. Welcome to you, sir.
Thanks. Welcome to you.
Here's your dram, Charlie.
Thank you, Angus.
And for you, sir, some claret.
Thanks.
I think I'll drink this one to Mr. Forsyth. I just hope he knows how grateful I am to him for postponing the miracle for me.
The what?
Shh! And may God bless me this evening as much as I would bless him if I were he, and he were Charles Dalrymple.
Aye.
What was that you said about postponing a miracle?
Oh, tis a toast we have here.
Take it down, I'll explain it to you sometime.
Say, that's wonderful. May I have another?
Was a wedding gesture, sir. If you want any more, you'll have to pay for it.
I've got to get some claret and ale for the supper. Come with me and you can have some more.
Fine.
Woolens, plaids.
He's an odd lad, isn't he?
Aye. He has a peculiar accent.
I wonder what American women must be like.
I don't wonder about women anymore, Angus. I'm not allowed to.
Aye, that's right, Charlie. You've given up on the lasses for good, haven't you?
I used to be a roving lad, roving and wandering life I had. Oh, then alas I drowned, oh, tried to slow me down. Then one day I saw a maid, held up her hand and I stayed and stayed. And now across the green, I'll go home with Bonnie Jean.
Go home with Bonnie.
when we are wedded, the friendship ends. They never come to call, so farewell to one and all. Farewell to all the lads I know. I'll see them again when they're married too. For soon across the green, I'll go home with Bonnie Jean.
Go home, go home, go home with Bonnie Jean. Go home, go home.
I'll go home with Bonnie Jean. In Edinburgh I used to know a lass with a hair and her name was Jo. And every night at 10 I would meet her in the glen.
Especially not in the glen at 10.
For now across the green, I'll go home with Bonnie Jean.
Go home, go home, go home with Bonnie Jean. Go home, go home.
I'll go home with Bonnie Jean. Hello to many men I've known. I'll soon have a wife and leave years alone. A funny wife and I will till the day I die. That's why across the green I'll go home with Bonnie Jean.
Go home, go home, go home with Bonnie Jean. Go home.
Thank you.
dearie, I'll be over. I hope, sir, you'll stay for the wedding supper.
Oh, thanks, but I won't be here that long.
It's a pity.
Charlie, what are we going to do all day?
Rest, dearie.
Rest. He's a nice kid.
Aye, he is that.
It's wonderfully refreshing to see a fellow so enthusiastic about getting married.
Is it so unusual?
I think it is. Look at me. I'm not bubbling over like Charlie. And next month I'm facing the minister.
You're getting married?
Yes.
Oh.
Oh, what?
Well, somehow you didn't look like the sort of lad who would want to settle down.
Well, I didn't say that. I just said I was getting married.
Well, then why are you?
Well, because the girl wants to.
Is that reason enough?
I think it is. I don't know how it is in the Highlands, but in my neighborhood, if you've been going with a woman for a while and she decides she wants to get married, you better agree right away and save yourself a lot of trouble.
Why?
Well, because if you don't, she'll either torment you so that you'll marry her for relief, or she'll be so sweet about it that you'll feel guilty and your conscience will make you do it.
Well, I must say it doesn't sound like you love her very much.
It doesn't, does it?
It also sounds like a very peculiar land you come from.
Well, believe me, lass, this isn't your usual hamlet off the highway either. What was that business about Charlie and the man who postponed the miracle?
Oh, that, I'm sorry, but I kinda say.
But you said you'd tell me later.
I know, but I kinda say.
That's fine. I'm sure if I stick around here long enough, I'll discover everyone's slightly nutty. Is that possible?
I kinda say.
Why not?
Because I didn't know what nutty means.
It means slightly insane.
Well, then I can assure you I'm very far from insane. What a most blessed group of people. And I never realize how fortunate we are till I meet someone from the outside. I mean a stranger to Brigadoon. I don't know anything about you, but from the little you've said, everything you think, I think differently about. And I'm also quite certain that which I think is much more, well, pleasant. And no, I'm sorry I said all that, but you angered me when you called us insane.
Hey, you don't like me very much, do you?
That's the odd part. I like you very much. I just didn't like anything you say.
Fiona?
I?
If I stuck around here for today, would you take me to the wedding this evening?
Why do you suddenly want to go?
I kinna say.
Well, then I'll take you. And I'll be highly pleased you'll be there.
You will? Why?
Because of what I just told you. I like you very much.
That's right. You did say that, didn't you?
Now I'll show you a place where you can lie down and get some rest.
What are you going to do?
Gather some heather for the wedding.
Where do you do that?
On the hill, where the heather is.
May I go with you?
No, I'll do it much faster alone.
I won't bother you, really. Maybe I'm the one who's slightly nutty, but...
Can't we two go walking together out beyond the valley of trees? Out where there's a hillside of heather, curtsying gently in the breeze. That's what I'd like to do, see the heather but with you. The mist of May is in the gloomy, and all the clouds are holding still. So take my hand and let's go roaming through the heather on the hill. The morning dew is blinking yonder, lazy music in the wind, and all I want to do is wander. Maybe other springs as full and fair, but they won't be the same. They'll come and go, for this I know, that when the mist is in the gloaming and all the clouds are holding still, if you're not there I won't go roaming through the heather.
Want to.
Yes. It almost sounded like I was in love with you, didn't it?
But there's a difference between being in love and just being sentimental because you're tired.
Is that what I was being? Sentimental because I'm tired?
I believe so, but it is very agreeable.
Don't you?
I
haven't been in an open shed like this since I was a boy, which seems a good 2,000 years ago.
You mean you're tired?
Aye, lassie, I'm tired. That's it. That is why you brought me here, isn't it? So I could take a nap?
I shouldn't think a long walk would fatigue a young lad like you.
A young lad?
Aye, you're very young.
That is either a deliberate lie or wishful thinking. I am ancient, decrepit, and disintegrating rapidly.
Aye.
Oh, what's under here, a rock garden?
My father used to sleep on it.
Well, that was his second mistake.
He and my mother met in this shed. You see, my mother was a gypsy.
Uh-huh.
And one day, she was walking past this shed, and she saw my father asleep here. She liked his looks, and she was a wee bit tired anyhow. So she took off her shoes, sat in the rocking chair, and waited for him to wake up. And it wasn't long after that that I was born.
That's one of the sweetest bedtime stories I've ever heard.
You sure you're comfortable?
Very. Thank you very much. You've been more than kind. And now, to round out your generosity, buzz off.
You're a broad, handsome lad.
You should see me when I'm rested. I'm almost robust.
I just hate to leave you.
You'd better. I make all sorts of odd noises when I sleep.
Who told you? Do you have a wife?
No. But I was engaged once.
What happened to the lass you were engaged to?
She fell in love with a Russian.
A Russian?
Yes.
Russia's in Europe, isn't it?
Yes, more and more. It's not far. You just cross the channel and go left.
Hi, you're a winning lad. A right winning lad.
Now, look, Les, I don't know what you're looking for, but I'm not interested. I just want to go to sleep.
But didn't you see? I'm highly attracted to you.
Thank you very much. When I wake up, we can discuss the whole problem, and believe me, you have a problem.
But when I see you lying on the cot, I feel little tadpoles jumping up and down my spine.
That's as repulsive an idea as I've ever heard. You know, if love were a hobby, you'd be a collector's item.
But I've been waiting so long.
Go.
Oh, you men are all alike.
I should certainly hope so.
You're all brutes. You get what you want from a lass, and then just farewell.
Get what I want? I can't even get you to go away.
That's what I'm referring to. I thought you were interested in me, and that's why you let me bring you here. You misled me.
You certainly have an active imagination. What would lead you to think that I, a strange man, would be interested in you, a strange woman, and at this hour of the day?
Because you're a lad, and I'm a lass.
With that philosophy, you must have had a provocative career.
Aye, I've had a great many heartbreaks.
I don't doubt it at all.
I was blue and sad. Then father said I should find a lad. So I set out to become a wife and found the kind of touch and a certain kind of eagerness that pleased me very much. his hand and I bid him goodbye. I never went back, for what I had heard was true, that a poet only writes about the things he cannot do. My pa said, look out for men who think, you'll be more certain with men who drink. So out I went to become a wife, found the real love of my life. Oh, he was a soldier, a fine Highland son. He told me about all the battles he won. He wasted his time telling me about his might, for one look at him decided me to not put up a fight. We skirmished for hours that night in the glen, and I found the sword has more might than the pen. But when I was drowsing, I snored to my dismay, and he thought it was a bugle and got up and marched away. My pa said, daughter, there must be one, someone who's true or too old to run. So I'm still looking to be a wife and find the real love of my life.
You should sign it beneath the name of my dear departed wife.
Aye, sir. Come in. Now, here, Mr. McLaren, I've brought your waistcoat.
Thank you, Harry. 'Tis good to see you. Now, wait a minute, lad.
What for?
Why didn't you shake my hand? I'm not your enemy.
Well, you may not mean to be, but you are. And so is everyone else in this town.
What is it, lad? Why do you go about hating everybody?
I couldn't get through this day of seeing her marry someone else if I didn't. What could I do? What could anyone do when they realize your life didn't mean a thing? I cannot leave here. I cannot go to the university and make something of myself. And I cannot have Jean. So, there's nothing left to do but hate everything and everybody in this cursed town.
You'll never get any peace by hating. This is only a cursed town if you make it so. To the rest of us, this is a blessed place.
You can keep it.
Well, all done. Who was that?
My waistcoat came.
Ah. Jeannie!
Charlie, please go away. I want to come out.
Don't obey her, lad. You'll spoil her.
Jeannie!
Charlie, please go away.
I can hardly wait for the wedding. Jeannie! Because they've told me I can't be born yet. Longing, there's nothing wrong in me standing out here and saying, oh, come to me, bend to me, kiss me good day, darling, my darling, 'tis all I can say, just come to me, bend.
Thank you.
I know, but I'm not sorry.
Wait for me. I shan't be a minute.
Good morning, laddie.
Hi. Where have you been?
This is very nice. Should have seen the apartment I got. Complete with a built-in lassie.
Come on in. What on earth happened to you?
Thistles.
What?
Never mind. It's a professional secret. Besides, my pants will be ready before we leave. Oh, and another thing. Forget all that rubbish about Scottish frugality. Their generosity is overpowering.
Well, how do you feel?
Surprisingly well. How about you?
I've never felt better in my life. You too?
Maybe the sun gave me the power, for I could swim Loch Lomond and be home in half an hour. Maybe the air gave me the drive, for I'm all aglow and alive. What a day this has been, what a rare mood I'm in. Why, it's almost like being in love. There's a smile on my face for the whole human race. Why, it's almost like being in love. All the music of life seems to be like a bell that is ringing for me. It's almost like being in love. When we walked up the bridge,
what a word did we say?
Andrew McLaren, July 2nd, 1719.
What's so amazing? People used to get married back then.
Wait a minute. Fiona, born October 10th, 1722. Jean, April 8th, 1728.
Well?
But Fiona's 24. And she's got a sister 6 years younger named Jean.
Well?
But those are the two names of the sisters in this Bible.
That's ridiculous. They're probably just named after them.
Jean's getting married today. Did you know that?
Yes.
Do you know the name of the guy she's marrying?
They told me at the tavern. Someone named Dalrymple.
Well, get this. Married Jean McLaren to Charles McPherson Dalrymple. June 12th, 1746. Now what do you say?
Congratulations.
Wait a minute. No Brigadoon on the map. No phones in the entire town. All thanks to Mr. Somebody for doing something about a miracle. And one or two other things I passed over while I was out this afternoon with Fiona.
That hyperthyroid I was with never heard of Hagen Haig.
I don't understand it. And I'm beginning to feel a little like a fool.
What are you getting so worked up about? If it makes them happy to disregard 200 years of human bing-bang, let them.
But I've just spent the most wonderful day of my life, and now I run into something like this. It doesn't make sense to me.
It does to me. It just means that batty people relax here.
She's not batty. She can't be. Fiona! There must be some logical explanation for this, even logical enough for you. Fiona!
They don't have to explain anything to me. I don't care.
What, Tommy?
Come here.
Tell me, what is it?
Is this your name here in this Bible?
Aye, and why? Oh.
Someone seems to have loused up your book.
Well, come on. What does it all mean? Is there an explanation or isn't there?
Aye, there is, but I cannot tell you.
Well, is there someone who can? I'd like to know.
You have to speak with the Dominie.
The who?
Our schoolmaster, Mr. Lundy.
Well, where does he live?
Down the road in a tree.
He doesn't live in a tree, Mr. Douglas. Mr. Lundy is a great man. All right, Tommy, I'll take you to him. I had no one to do, because I was hoping we could have this day together.
What's that got to do with it?
It'll be so hard for you to believe what you'll hear. You'll think there's something wrong with us, and you'll leave. I know it.
Well, maybe I will, and maybe I won't. Come on, Jeff.
Is it informal, or should I wear my three-cornered hat?
Come on, I said.
Thank you.
day, Mr. Lundy.
Why, hello, Fiona. What a pleasant surprise.
Mr. Lundy, I'd like to meet Mr. Tommy Albright and Mr. Jeff Douglas.
How do you do, gentlemen?
How do you do, sir?
Good afternoon.
Where do you gentlemen come from?
We're from New York.
We're from New York.
Uh-huh.
Yes. New York.
Aye, I heard you.
Mr. Lundy, I was wondering if you'd be good enough to tell these gentlemen about Brigadoon. They've heard and seen a great deal and are very perplexed indeed.
Perplexed is right.
I would very much like him, I mean them, to know.
I would very much like him, I mean them, to know.
Aye, sir.
When are you be seated, gentlemen? Are you staying for your?
If I may, sir, I'd love to hear it all again.
Of course.
From what I gather, no one can talk about anything around here but you. Is that right?
No, that's wrong. Mr. Forsyth could have told you.
Forsyth. I've heard about him, but I haven't met him.
Likely not. I think he's dead.
That would stand in the way, I suppose.
Let me warn you before I begin. Now, what I'm going to tell you, you will not believe.
It's all right. We've been warned. Why won't we believe it?
Because what happened in Brigadoon was a miracle. And most folk do not believe in miracles. Miracles require faith. And faith seems to be as dead as,
Mr. Forsyth?
Aye. Now, there's some outsider who chanced to come to Brigadoon, were to hear the tale from the lips of someone in town, he'd think the poor lass or lad was daft. And that would lead to many unpleasant and humiliating things for the poor lass or laddie now, wouldn't it?
I suppose so.
I suppose so. So, only I am allowed to talk about the miracle to strangers.
And you don't imagine anybody would think you're crazy.
You might very well. But it wouldn't hurt me. I just pity you. Now, this miracle happened, let's see, what's today?
Friday.
That means it happened exactly 200 years ago. 200 years ago, the Highlands of Scotland were plagued with witches, wicked sorcerers who were taking the Scottish folk away from the teachings of God and putting the devil in their souls. They were indeed horrible, destructive women. I do not suppose ye have such women in your world.
Witches?
Yes, we still have them. We pronounce it differently.
Uh-huh. It did not matter they were not real sorcerers, because as ye and I know, there is no such thing. But their influence was very real indeed. Now, here in Brigadoon, we had an old minister of the Kirk named Mr. Forsyth. And a good man he was.
The kindest man in Scotland.
I believe he was. No man ever loved his parish as did Mr. Forsyth. But he was growing old, and it grieved him to think that one day soon he'd have to leave all those so dear to him. But most of all, he worried about the witches. They had not visited Brigadoon yet, but he knew there was a band of them coming our way. So he began to wonder if there wasn't something he could do to protect the folk of his parish, not only from the witches, but from all the evils that might come to Brigadoon from the outside world after he died.
What a kind man.
He spent many days walking through the glen, thinking. And if you passed his house at any hour of the night, you'd have seen the candle lit, and Mr. Forsyth sitting in his chair, thinking. Then one day he came to me, and he told me he decided to ask God for a miracle. He consulted with me about it, because he knew I have a highly logical mind, and he figured as long as he was going to ask for a miracle, it might as well be a well-organized miracle. So, for many days, I walked with him through the glen, and for many nights, I sat with him by candlelight. Finally, Mr. Forsyth decided what he was going to pray for, and on an early Wednesday morning, just after midnight, he went out to a hill beyond the Brigadoon and made his prayer to God. There in the hush of a sleeping world, he asked God that night to make Brigadoon and all the people in it vanish into the Highland mists. Vanish, but not for always. It would all return, just as it were, for one day every 100 years. The people would go on leading their customary lives, but each day when they awakened, it would be 100 years later. And when we awoke the next day, it was 100 years later.
Unbelievable.
You see, in this way, Mr. Forsyth figured there could be no change in the lives of the people. They just would not be in any century long enough to be touched by it.
You mean you go to sleep at night, and when you wake up the next morning, it's 100 years later?
Aye.
So every day is 100 years later?
Aye.
What happened to the minister?
We never saw him again. You see, he realized that to ask for such a miracle, some sacrifice would have to be made, and he wanted to be the one to make it. Now, what greater sacrifice could he offer than to be separated for his time from the ones he loved? So that's why he went out to a hill beyond Brigadoon. Were the miracle granted, he would never see Brigadoon again.
And all this happened 200 years ago?
Aye, lad. Which, you see, is only 2 days ago to us. He had intended to ask for the miracle on Tuesday, but Charles Dalrymple was in school in Edinburgh and was not expected back until Tuesday late. And Mr. Forsyth, not wanting anything to go wrong with the wedding, postponed praying until Charlie got back.
Wasn't that sweet of him?
Suppose somebody gets fed up and wants to leave. Can he?
He cannot leave.
You mean I've got to stay here now?
No, no, lad. But if someone of Brigadoon leaves, the enchantment is broken for all.
And?
That night, when the people go to sleep, Brigadoon will disappear forever.
Look, I'm not saying that I believe all this, but just for argument's sake, suppose a stranger, like, well, me, comes to Brigadoon and wants to stay. Can he?
Aye, lad, he can. Mr. Forsyth provided for that.
He didn't miss a trick, did he?
No, lad, he didn't. A stranger can stay if he loves someone here. Not just Brigadoon, mind you, but someone in Brigadoon. Enough to leave all else and stay with that one person. Which is how it ought to be. Because after all, if you love someone deeply, anything is possible.
I think I like that part the best.
Shouldn't you be thinking about changing for the wedding?
Oh, aye, I had. Tommy, will I see you later?
Yes, I'll be here.
Thank you, Tommy.
I think I want to stick around and see if this place really evaporates, like you say.
I must hurry now. Thank you, Mr. Lundy.
She's a dear lass.
I'm beginning to find that out. Tell me, Mr. Lundy, you're all perfectly happy living here in this little town?
Of course, lad. After all, sunshine can peep through a small hole.
But at night, when you go to sleep, what's it like?
Well, for me, it is like being carried off on shadowy arms to some far-off cloud, and there I float till morning. And yet, sometimes I think I hear strange voices.
Voices?
Aye. They say no words I can remember, but their voices filled with a fearful longing, and often they seem to be calling me back. I've pondered it when I'm awake, and I have a feeling, I think it must be the outside world. There must be a lot of folk out there who'd like a Brigadoon. Oh, tis the wedding time.
Dalrymple.
We have no minister in Brigadoon now. In most villages, this would be a calamitous thing, but we know 'tis a blessing. When there is no minister present, it is perfectly proper, according to the laws of Scotland, for two people to be wed by sincere, mutual consent. There need be nothing in writing. All that's necessary is the promise of love, as long as ye both shall live. Go ahead, lad.
I shall love ye till I die, and I'll make all effort to be a good husband to ye.
And so much, I'll try to be a mine and loving wife.
I know Mr. Forsyth would have liked to have been here, but if you'll both be good and true to one another, you cannot help but live in the grace of God, and he could have asked for no more than that.
Are we married now, Mr.
Glendy? Are we married now, Mr. Glendy? Aye, lad. Ye are married.
Thank you.
done is wanting you too much. I'm leaving Brigadoon. Tis the end of us all.
No!
The miracle's over.
No!
Run it!
Get out!
Thank you.
dead, and we cannot be told by the hand of that either hand. For the prey, keep your eye open, ye want to find him, laddie.
I'll go down to the creek, and by George, if I find him, I'll throw him in it.
Search the hill to the peak, find him, lad, or tomorrow will never, never come.
Run and get him!
Get him!
This must not be tonight. They must know that tomorrow is really gonna come.
Run and get him,
get him.
Run and get him,
get him.
Spread your human net, but don't forget that time's a guinea. Go and stop him,
stop him.
Go and stop him,
stop him.
Run, ye Highland men, or ye won't ken another day.
Say a prayer, I'm afraid our return is there. Looks like he fell on the rock and it crushed in his head.
Nobody wanted for Harry to be spent out. All that we wished was to keep him from leaving the till tomorrow that beaten is dead. They'll find he's dead tomorrow. Tell them all is right. There should be no more sorrow.
Right, dearie, he was stopped.
Thank heaven.
Was your head bad?
No, dear, just a bit scratched is all. There's no need for grieving now. We need to get on with the wedding supper.
He didn't get away, did he, Mr. McLaren?
No, Archie, he didn't.
Then where is my son? I want to see him. I thank God you stopped him from his terrible intention, but I want to see him.
You needn't worry about him. He's in good hands. Come, Archie, join us for a bit of wedding supper.
I cannot join you, Mr. McLaren. I'm too ashamed for him.
But, Archie, come everybody back to the glen for some food and ale. The alarm is over.
Angus, have you seen Tommy?
The American, Fiona? No, I did not think he came back with us.
Fiona!
Tommy! Oh, I thought you might have gone.
No, I didn't go. I couldn't.
And you're all right?
Of course I'm all right.
I'd have died if anything had happened to you. I love you so.
You...
I...
But how can you be sure after one day?
I didn't know. It's just... When a lass falls in or out of love, she knows it. Right away.
I wish my emotions could be that clear to me.
Why?
Because... feels like I'm hearing my own secret being told.
You mean, you think you're in love with me?
Think? What good does thinking do? If I thought about it, it wouldn't make any more sense than the miracle. But what I feel is something different.
What do you feel, Tommy?
This is hard to say, but as I wandered through the leaves, I felt for just a fleeting moment that I suddenly was free of being lonely. Then I closed my eyes and saw the very reason why I saw.
Someone could stay if he loved someone enough?
Aye.
Well, that's for me. Where do I go? Who do I talk to? Where do I get my passport to disappear?
Oh, Tommy.
I don't want to be without you ever again. I'd be afraid to be.
I saw a man who had never known
waited 93 while he could. Then up the road came Ed McKean with half the town of Aberdeen.
And everyone was on the skiers and on his wedding day.
Then all of a sudden the liquor was gone, the gin and the whiskey and all. And all of a sudden the wedding affair had become a bonny brawl. Pete McGraw and Joe McPhee began to fight for May McGee. Well, May McGee and Sam McKee were a wooing in trouble. The stiff was John McVeigh, they used him for a snuff.
And everyone was fighting it and all his wedding day.
McKenna was eating the bridal bouquet and McNeil hung on the wall. Finally my father came, his eyes were red, his nose aflame. He didn't even know his name, he was drunkest of them all. The people were lying all over the room, looking as if they were dead. Then mother uncovered the minister quick and she told him, go ahead.
Hi.
Jeff! I'm not going back with you.
Just for the record, what are you talking about?
I'm staying here.
You're pulling my bonny leg, aren't you?
No! I've never been more serious in my life. I tell you, Jeff, in one day, I feel more part of her and this place than I've ever felt about Jane or anything or anybody else back home.
My dear boy, that's because it is one day. You realize if you stay here, it's for always.
I know.
And do you know how long always is around here? It's one heck of a long time.
I know.
This can't be a trial marriage, because you can't change your mind after 600 or 700 years of trying it out.
I won't ever want to.
You're absolutely positive that there'll never come a time when you miss your family, your friends, the life you belong to. How can you know that now?
Because, well, and here's where I know you'll think I'm crazy. Because I believe her. And what's more, I believe in this place.
You do not. You just want to. This Highland voodoo town makes no more sense to me than it does to you. So how can you believe in something when you don't even understand it? When you leave here in a few weeks or even a few days, you'll forget all about it. You won't feel a thing. That's the way a dream is.
What do you mean, a dream?
That's what this is, a dream. Why, even now, you're not really moved by it. You just think you are.
But how do you know?
Because I do. Did you see that funeral here a moment ago?
Yes. Why?
I'm responsible for it.
What?
Harry Beaton. I killed him.
You did what?
I killed him. Accidentally, of course, but nevertheless, I killed him. Out in the forest tonight, I saw him rushing past me from behind a bush. Without even thinking what I was doing, I stuck out my foot and down he went. I heard his head hit a rock with a very nasty thud.
Oh, Jeff, I'm so sorry.
What for?
Well, you must feel half dead inside.
On the contrary, I don't feel a thing.
You actually don't feel anything?
Nothing, except like going home.
But why don't you?
Because this is a dream, a good one for you and a bad
one for me. Wait a minute! Will you?
You see, I've confused you, haven't I?
Yes, you have.
And if you really believed all that you think you do, I couldn't do that. I'll wait for you outside the town.
Tommy, what did he mean?
Fiona tells me you want to stay, lad.
Tommy, what is it?
It's no good, Fiona. I'm leaving. And it isn't because I don't love you. I think I do, but I guess I just don't trust my own feelings.
You mean you're not sure you can accept everything?
That's about it, I guess.
You better hurry, Fiona. There's not much time left. Don't feel ashamed of yourself, Tommy. 'Tis the hardest thing in the world to give everything, even though 'tis usually the only way to get everything.
Do you understand it all?
about anything.
I'm not. In fact, I shouldn't be surprised if I'm less lonely now than I was before you came. I think real loneliness is not being in love in vain, but not being in love at all.
But it'll fade in time.
No, I don't want to do that.
Drinking it.
Continuously since you got back from Scotland 4 months ago.
Well, I just decided I don't like it. Besides, it's not as good as the whiskey Mother used to make. Pour me some gin.
What do you have with it?
A little bourbon.
Yes, sir.
Francis, could you tell me the time? I think my watch has stopped.
6:10.
Huh. I'd better be getting home. Pour me another. I like to drink portal to portal.
It's just about this time for Miss Ashton to call.
Who?
Jane Ashton. Mr. Albright's fiancée. Don't tell me you don't remember her.
All right, I won't. What about her?
Well, it's just this time she either calls or comes in or both looking for Mr. Albright.
She does, huh?
Yeah, and from what I gather, she can't find him.
Well, I'm glad you warned me. I'll drink up and head home.
Don't you like Miss Ashton, sir?
Of course I do. Just not when she's stalking Mr. Albright.
Then where is Mr. Albright?
I don't know, Francis. He quit his job about a month ago, picked up his parcels, and vanished. Like Brigadoon.
Like who?
It's the name of my older brother who ran away.
Hi.
Good evening, Mr. Albright. Sir.
Tommy! It's my old friend, Tommy!
How are you, Jeff?
It's Tommy! He's back!
Hi, Francis.
Where you been, Tommy?
Up on a farm in New Hampshire.
Oh, a farm? Mess around in all that dirty dirt and everything. What were you doing up there?
Enjoying myself. Ryan soda, please, Francis.
Yes, sir.
Well, if you like it so much, when you get married, why don't you buy one?
I'm not sure I want to get married, Jeff.
Why?
Because, my dear old tank, I'm in love with someone else, and I cannot get over it.
Oh.
And the trouble is, because I can't be with her, I can't be with anyone else. And that's why I went away. So many things remind me of her. I can be talking with someone, and they can say one little word that opens the door to a memory, and all of a sudden, I don't hear them anymore. I'm a few thousand miles away with her. And then slowly I drift back to the conversation, and they ask me a question, and I don't know what they're talking about. I haven't heard a word.
You must be fascinating company.
When I'm alone, it's easier.
Tommy!
Jane!
What a wonderful surprise.
Hello, Jane.
When did you get back.
Hello, Jeff.
A little while ago.
How are you, Jeff?
I have been worried half to death about you.
Fine, Jeff. How are you?
I've been looking
at you. I've been fine, other than a cold.
I must say, you do look wonderful.
So do you. Well, I don't want to eat and run, but I think I'll go back up to my room. I'll talk to you later, Jeff.
Hello.
Goodbye. Put it on the bill, Francis.
Your bill, sir, is awfully high.
So am I.
Tommy, why did you write me?
Nothing to say, I guess. Drink?
Old fashioned, please. And why didn't you wire me where you were coming in? After all, darling, I did think the minute you get into town, you'd either call me or come to me.
Maybe.
You mean you'd even consider it?
Consider what?
Commuting from 60 miles out of New York.
Oh, no. I wouldn't want to do that.
I didn't think so. And I told Mr. Jackson.
Who?
Herbert Jackson.
Oh. Who's he?
I just told you. He's a real estate man I've been working with. I told him you'd call him.
I can hardly wait.
Please do. I'm trying so hard to arrange everything. Do you still want Jeff to stand up for you?
Well, yes. If he can. Why?
Nothing. It's just that he's so impossible these days. Everyone is bored to death with him.
I'm not interested in everybody. Especially the everybody we know.
Well, you have been certainly antisocial since you returned from Scotland. If you really want to avoid everybody, why don't we take Mr. Jackson's house? It's far away and right on top of a high, beautiful hill.
On my feet, kiss to face in front of me.
Jane, no.
No what?
I can't go through with it. There's going to be no wedding next month.
Do you mean you're postponing it again?
No, I'm not postponing it. I'm calling it off for good.
Calling it off?
I can't do it. Ever.
You have the nerve. After all this time I've waited for you and tried to be patient and put up with your idiotic whims and temperament.
I'm sorry. It's not your fault. You've been wonderfully kind to me, but something happened to me a few months ago that I can't explain. Now I don't fit in here anymore.
Well, I think you're going clean out of your mind, but I refuse to stand here and argue with you in public. Let's go home.
Go home, go home, go home with Bonnie Jean. Go home, go home, oh, go home with Bonnie Jean.
You're all alone!
I think we are the
please. Jeff, are you awake? I want to go back to Scotland. I said I want to go back to Scotland. Never mind what for. You want to go with me? We'll get a plane reservation right away. I know it isn't there, but I want to see that voice. I want to go, do you hear me? I want to go! Between the mist and the stars, there's someone I want so badly. She's not dead, just asleep. And yet, I'll never see her again.
You came all the way out here just to say that. You realize you could have told me that over the phone in New York for a nickel.
No, I'll tell you why. She became so real to me that I had to come back for myself and see that the place really wasn't there.
Didn't work that way for me. It's so much like a dream to me now that I'd have to work hard to convince myself it happened at all.
There's the big difference between us.
Tell me about it.
I found that sometimes what you believe in becomes more real to you than anything you can explain away or understand. Why do people have to lose things to find out what they really mean?
Take one last look and let's start walking. I got lost around here once.
Okay.
You should not be too surprised, lad. After all, I told you, when you love someone deeply, anything is possible. Even a medal.